So, let's prepare for the last talk today in this room number one. If you want to hear something about building content-driven shopping experience with Neos and Shopware, then you are in the right room. If you want to hear something about how agencies can profit from open source, then you have to switch the room. Now we have a marriage between a content management system and a shop, and we have two experts, the king of Atomic Fusion and the shopping queen.
Please welcome on stage Martin Fitze and Miriam Müller.
Hello. We're still waiting for the slides. That's the wrong one. Also on this screen, please, the speaker notes. Hello. Welcome, my name is Martin Fitzel, and I'm a backend developer at Zeitgeist. You can reach me on Twitter and on Slack, and I'm also a member of the Neos team, where I usually focus on Atomic Fusion and AFX. And I'm also one of the maintainers of Zeitgeist Monocle, which I created together with Wilhelm Behnke.
Hello, my name is Miriam. I'm working as a PHP developer at Zeitgeist, and I'm working with Shopware and since 2014. Before that, I worked with Magento for some years, but I think Shopware is a better system. In my free time, I play badminton. As you maybe know, Zeitgeist works with content management system with Neos and Shopware as shop system. And sometimes we have projects where it's not 100% clear whether a shop or content management system is needed. Features of both systems are required. That's why we thought about connecting both together. Why did we do that? What problems occurred during the implementation, and how does our solution look like? We will talk about that in the next half hour. How many of you know Shopware? Oh, okay. And how many of you are using Shopware in projects? Okay. I would try to tell you a little bit about Shopware. Shopware is a German open source system from Schöpping. That's near Münster in Germany. And they started as a small project, and Shopware exists for 18 years now with round about 80,000 customers. Some of the technology Shopware use, for example, Smarty and XJS, are not state of the art anymore. The core of Shopware is a big, big monolith, and that's why Shopware started refactoring the core. And they noticed, well, refactoring would take too much time. So they stopped the process at the moment, and they started a complete rewrite of the Shopware, software. And the working title of that is Shopware Next. Maybe some of you already heard about it. And yeah, maybe also some one of you knows a similar process about that between Type 3 and Neos. We will see what will go on with Shopware here. Here are some brands who are using Shopware as a shop system, but there are many, many more. Here you can see the backend of Shopware. Most data are maintained in complex lists and input masks. This makes sense for the maintenance of complex structured data like products. This example is a product list, and the input mask of our product detail. And here's an example of how landing pages are maintained in shopping worlds inside of Shopware. There's a grid view for each viewport and where you can place single components. And to edit one component, you also has this complex input mask like the product. That's okay for small landing pages, but you get confusing for more complex content. So summarized, some positive benefits of Shopware. Shopware is good to handle complex products with different variants such as colors and sizes. Shopware is managing complex price calculation with different taxes and customer prices and discounts. And the checkout and the payment process is really good. And Shopware has a big ecosystem of plugins, which helps you to extend the checkout and also the connections to payment providers. But Shopware is no content management system. The shopping worlds are good for small landing pages, but it's not enough to handle complex content.
So now Neos, I assume most of you know it. Neos is especially editor-friendly, and it's absolutely flexible when it comes to rendering and to modeling content. And to us important, we can create a style guide and preview it and create a component system. And obviously, Neos is no shopping. Is no shop system, so we have no shopping cart, we have no price calculation there, and no stock management, no checkout. And no plugin system for that, so there is not an ecosystem we can rely on. That is why we obviously want both, and we're using both systems in our projects. And both system has its specific benefits. That's why we often see that customers both have a CMS and a shop, or a Neos website and a shop, which is easy in the beginning, but quite hard when you have high visual expectations and you want both, you want an equal user experience in the CMS and in the shop, and you want live product data in the CMS world. So these are the aspects that quickly get complicated when you're running two different systems. So what did we try to solve this? We still want to have both systems, and we want to have each system do what it does best. So we want Shopware to be responsible for managing stock, prices, variants of products, handle shopping cart informations and checkouts. And of course, we want to use a plugin ecosystem for that to include different payment providers and stuff like that. And we want to use Neos to allow editors to focus on storytelling, explaining things. And we assume that it is not an issue that there are two different backend systems, since the editors that will create stories about products are usually not the same as the product managers who are managing how many items are in the stock, how many variants exist for a product, and what's the actual prices. So having two systems is not really a problem from the backend side. What we want to achieve is a unique user experience in the front end. And what we did to achieve that is a project we called Zeitgeist Golden Gate, a bridge between Neos and Shopware. And Miriam will tell you everything about the Shopware store.
one of the most important things we started to think about is a data bridge between Shopware and Neos. It is necessary to provide product data from Shopware to Neos with the option to filter by categories or product properties. First, we tried to use the existing Shopware Classic API, but after a short time, we noticed that the Classic API is focused on inventory management systems. Prices are without tags, so Neos should take care of tax calculation. Also, prices are not rounded for presentation. The Classic API, for example, provides 4 digits after the decimal point, and we think that's not the job of Neos to format prices. Shopware should deliver prices in such a way that they can be used for presentation. That means including tax calculation and rounding. Another problem we found, the Classic API delivers no absolute URLs to product detail pages and product images. And yeah, in addition, Shopware delivers a lot of data which are not relevant for content management systems. And yeah, because of all the irrelevant data, the core API is too slow to display products in search lists in the Neos backend. And yeah, that was how Martin looks when I told him to use the Shopware Classic API. yeah. here you can see an example of the Classic API, how the images are rendered. That's not useful for Neos. You have to call additional API request to get more useful URLs, but they are still without the base domain. And so Neos should deal with complex, with complete image URLs, and we also think that's not the job of Neos. We first tried to solve all our problems by extending the existing Classic API, but more and more adjustments were added, and we decided to leave the Classic API in place and build up our own API endpoints, and we called them the Zeitgeist Golden Gate API. Our API is focused on product presentation and performance. The Golden Gate API provides useful URLs for product detail pages and images. All tax calculation and price formatting is done by the Golden Gate API on the Shopware side, and yeah, Neos can take the information from the Golden Gate API, use it directly, and is not forced to deal around with formatting URLs and prices. And yeah, that's how Martin looked when he saw our new Golden Gate API.
Ah. Good to know.
yeah, we use data transfer objects and the Symfony serializer from our Golden Gate package to generate our JSON format for the API. We use data transfer objects on the Shopware side, as well as on the Neos side to exchange data. We have a clear structure and communication basis between both systems. We have small reference objects, which only contains the ID and the label, and are used for lists and filters. And we have detailed objects, which provides all necessary information. The reference objects give us the possibility to that data lists can be queried quickly, and detailed information will be requested when needed. yeah, the Golden Gate API is performing really good. And yeah, the graphic shows how the conversion from PHP object to JSON format is done on both sides. And yeah, here's an example of a small reference object. We have an ID and a label, and the output is the JSON. And the detail object is more complex, and the JSON looks like that. We have absolute URLs for product detail pages and also absolute URLs for the images. And yeah, the prices are formatted correct for presentation, and we have information about the currency. This is all DTOs we use in the Golden Gate API at the moment. We have product references and product details for the product, the same for filters and categories. And here is a list of our API endpoints we have at the moment. We will add more in the future if needed.
So now we have an API and we have a package of transfer objects we use on the Shopware side and on the Neos side. How do we integrate that into Neos? The classic approach of including an external API is often used is something I call a micro application, where you have special controllers, models, and templates, which sometimes sync API domain models or encapsulate API calls, and then use templates to actually render some data, and all this is wrapped into a content element wrapper around this micro application, which the editors actually use to put this thing into some place, but it's kind of closed. And while it works, it has some drawbacks, especially if you want to extend it. So mostly in such systems, you can only replace a template. And if you want to add extra data or fetch some data from somewhere else and render it or render it completely different, you easily run into trouble. And you either get a plugin that tries to have all features that might one customer request at some point of time, or you get a thing that is too simple to be actually useful. So we wanted something that is more like Raspberry Pi. We want the tools that we can use to create a flexible system. And to do that, we split the integration into three layers. On the lowest layer, we created EEL helpers, which are responsible for accessing the API and return the transfer objects that Miriam just showed. On top of that, we have a package that provides mix-ins that allow us to reference products or lists of products, and those lists of products are specified by criteria like categories, filter group options, or price range. And only on the third layer, we implemented a plugin that an editor can actually use, and only this layer makes assumptions how it can be used, and or makes assumptions what an editor might want to do with this data. And we expect the plugin layer to be replaced in almost any project, so we just call it plugin example. So how does the lowest layer of this API work? In the first line, you see the API product helper. And to this one, you simply pass a shop identifier and an article number. Of course, you can also pass an article reference object. And what you get back is a product detail object, the domain transfer object from the DTO package. For finding multiple products by criteria, you can use the product references helper. And this helper also expects a shop identifier and then product criteria like price, range, categories, or filter group options. And What you get back is a list of product reference objects that you can later on use with the product helper to get the detailed data for the items you actually want to display. We have some similar helpers to access categories and filter group options, but they work almost like this, so I will not show them separately. The mixin layer, on top of that, provides mainly two abstract node types. The first one just allows to select a single product. First, you select the shop, and afterwards, a data source will allow you to select between all products this shop offers. And the second one allows to select a list of shops. In this case, you also select the shop first, and afterwards, you define the criteria for the products you want to fetch. And a neat addition we added here is that we allow to manually select some products which are prepended to the list. So this allows the editor to say, yes, I want some fish, but at first I want to have some, some steak. A list of fishes which at first starts with a single steak. However, whatever an editor wants, like we cannot make many assumptions here. So on the third layer, we actually use this data, and we do it with Fusion, and we use Fusion object from the mixin layer, which gets passed the node that actually uses the product's mixin and will return us the product data that we can pass into a collection and use directly for rendering. If you know the principles of Atomic Fusion, you will know this pattern, and it's quite simple. We get a product and access a title and pass it to a teaser component, which is, in this case, from the plugin example package, but we expect that almost every project will replace this with custom code. But this is the only custom code, or the only code on this layer that has to be replaced. All the other code can stay the same. So as you can see, this is how it looks in the backend. The example contains two content node types, a large teaser that will show a single product, and a list of teasers that are defined by criteria. But again, it's just an example. It's just a suggestion how it can be used. You should replace this. In the front end, we now have some data from Shopware inside Neos Demo. And we use the full flexibility of Fusion mapping to display this data. So the markup that is generated here and how the list is displayed, is it a slider or not, is totally flexible. We make no assumptions here, and you can create a ton of custom node types that in some way or the other refer to Shopware products. We have the data, we render it, but now we have a problem with data consistency. We have two distinct systems, and of course, shopping data is almost every time quite sensitive. So whenever someone changes a price or changes the availability of a product, he expects that this change is reflected immediately also on the CMS side. How do we achieve this? Well, it turns out Neos already has all we need to do that quite easy. And the interesting part is cache tagging. And this is usually done in Fusion anyway. So every Fusion object, or very often Fusion items, are annotated with cache tags, so they are stored separately. And by caching items, Fusion allows us to not only to store an item with an identifier and a lifetime, but also it adds some tags which allow to specify in which situations this item is is thrown away even before the lifetime ends. That's a nice thing. And since such cache tags basically can be used to describe events that trigger the re-evaluation, we want to use them to make sure that whenever changes in Shopware are made, the rendered Fusion code gets re-evaluated again. This is how this is done. And to perform this, we added an extra EEL helper to create product tags or cache tags for specific Shopware products. And if you add those tags to the rendered Fusion code, this code will be evaluated again after the product was changed in Shopware. The nice thing is that the integrators that have to use this are almost every time already familiar with the concept of tagging Fusion cache items. This is how the data flow looks. Fusion is the master in the middle. It performs the API calls. It stores its information it once creates in the cache and avoids calling the API again and creates the HTML. But whenever a relevant event occurs in Shopware, this event is directly transferred to the cache and will force the re-evaluation of certain items that are tagged for this product. So the caching we use is implemented on two levels. So we not only cache on Fusion level, we also cache on the API request level. So if we fetch a list of products, we do not set for every request in the backend, but we will request the list again whenever a product changes. And so we cache API requests and the rendered Fusion content. And the cache invalidation is triggered by flow controllers that accept transfer objects and know which Fusion cache tags or which cache tags have to be flushed on the Neos side. To do that, there is also a Shopware package on the other side, which will create the actions and send requests to the flow controllers. Yeah. So we can render Shopware data in Neos. We can re-evaluate this data transparently whenever things change in Shopware. But another thing we wanted to achieve is visual consistency. And how do we do that? We have two separate systems. Both have totally different rendering systems. So it's almost impossible, or it may be possible in the beginning, to create a unique user experience on both sides. But especially over time, it will be really hard to maintain this. And we wanted to find a solution for that. And in fact, we already had customers who asked us that, how we want to achieve that. And half a year ago, we did not have an answer. But in the meantime, we thought about, so how do we achieve visual consistency in Neos? So what are we doing there? And in Neos, we have a tool. And this is what we call Sitecast Monocle. And we use it to preview presentational components, independent from all integration logic. And what is a presentational component? A presentational component is a Fusion component that encapsulates all visual aspects for the representation of a data structure. This includes the generation of markup, styling, and also script interaction. Such presentational components are side effect free, but they may use other presentational components internally. So it's an important concept, and it's quite simple and allows us to create components that are really reusable in Neos, but they actually do not rely very much on an underlying CMS system. In the Monocle style guide, we can preview these components, and the style guide already works totally without database. And right now we use this in almost every Neos project. And the style guide allows us to preview not only the component, but also the generated HTML. And it also shows us another interesting thing. And this is the Fusion syntax tree. What is that? The Fusion syntax tree describes the completely parsed Fusion. So the Fusion code with all includes from all packages that is present in your current system. And this syntax tree is cached, and it's all the Fusion runtime needs during runtime. Strange sentence, but I think it's correct. it's quite simple. It's a large hash map. Why don't we take it with us? So the first thing we did, we wanted to export this syntax tree to use it outside of Neos as well. and we created a package called Zeitgeist Monocle Component Export. And what it does is it first finds the prototypes that can be exported. Not all Fusion prototypes that are in NEOS make sense outside of NEOS in any way. There's many domain logic in there. And we not only wanted to detect the prototypes we want to export, but also the prototypes they rely on. And we wanted to create render passes for each prototype so that we can render them separately outside. But this is quite similar to what Monocle already does in the preview window. The result is a much smaller Fusion syntax tree than in NEOS itself. And it contains only the relevant prototypes and their dependencies and some renderers. And we can store this as a JSON file. To actually execute this outside of NEOS, we created standalone runtimes for Fusion and EEL that we can use in almost any PHP environment. And almost everything we had to do is to remove the dependency injection and some dependencies to flow. It was actually not that hard. And now we have two packages that are standalone runtimes, and we created them in the Zeitgeist namespace, but of course, on the long run, the core packages of Fusion and EEL should be able to do that as well. We not only need the Fusion runtime and the EEL runtime, we also needed some helpers. But for this, we could focus on the Fusion objects and the EEL helpers that are used for presentational code. So we had a pretty clear understanding what we would need on the other side. So this is tag attributes, value, things like that, collection, not that complicated. So with all this infrastructure in place, we could create a shopware package that encapsulated the Fusion standalone runtime, and on top of that, a component package that encapsulates an exported Fusion AST together with the matching JavaScript and CSS. And this package then exposes the Fusion components as Smarty helpers. So this is how it looks if you want to use a Fusion component in Smarty. The package that these helpers can be auto-generated since they are a one-to-one mapping for a given syntax tree. So we now have Fusion components not only in NEOS, but also in Shopware. So these are the same components rendered in the Shopware demo shop. Of course, you can apply this principle not only to teasers, but also to menus or similar stuff. And by doing so, we can really create a smooth experience. We have the same component on both sides. And the package that contains the Smarty helpers and the syntax tree is an artifact for the build chain. So we can create it again whenever we change the style guide. Yeah, that's what we have. Fusion everywhere. And this makes NEOS together with Monocle the single source of truth for all visual aspects across multiple systems. At least to me that makes sense.
Yeah, that was a lot of information. Let's recap what we achieved. We can access and render transfer objects from Shopware in NEOS. That's our Golden Gate data bridge. We get transparent updates via events and custom cache tags. And we export components from NEOS to be used in Shopware. That's Fusion standalone and Fusion renderer. And what did we learn until now? One of our first learnings was that the shopping APIs are not built for content management systems. And we think data transfer objects and the Symfony serializer are very nice as basic for APIs, especially between PHP systems. And EEL helpers a good integration base, and the cache, custom caches and tags makes the integration smooth between Shopware and Neos. And standalone Fusion and Eel just works.
I made her say that.
Yeah, and what do we plan to do next? We need something like subshops and language support, and maybe a fluent interface for product queries. And we also plan to use Shopware as SSO provider to share login session between Shopware and Neos. And we also need access to the shopping cart and the user data from Neos site. And yeah, the last thing we also plan to do is product overlays and category overlays in Neos for special products with individual content. Here you can see an overview of all our packages for Neos and Shopware. You can find all of them on GitHub. At the moment, all packages are Dev Master. We will first tag a version when we use them in productive systems. And yeah, pull requests are welcome. Yeah, thank you very much for your attention.
Yes, thank you, Martin. Thank you, Miriam. And again, please do not forget to rate the talk. And you are lightning fast. You saved us almost 10 minutes. That's pretty cool. And that means the next topic, the Neos Award, will start at 17:20. We can't use those 10 minutes because we have to wait for the other session. That means we have some minutes to build up here for the ceremonies, and then we will start with the Neos Award sponsored by Mitwald. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't get it.
Hello. What is your strategy on the checkout process?
To use Shopware at the moment.
Okay.
The interesting thing is checkout process contains payment providers. There are legal issues I really don't want to deal with. So there is an ecosystem there already that has plugins that can deal with all that. So for the beginning, our plan is to just use Shopware for that and use Neos for the storytelling part, but create a smooth experience when you're traveling between both worlds. Thanks.
Is Shopware worth it? Like, in the sense of, isn't there a shopping system which is basically an API and not a weird system of its own, which you can't really control from a CMS?
No, there are only some parts available in the API. That's the products and categories and order data, but you don't have control over everything over the API. At the moment, they are working on that for the next Shopware version, for Shopware Next. Everything should be useful as API.
But if you would use a shop that is only an API, you would have to deal with creating all the editing interfaces you need to manage the products in Neos. And that would be quite a task. And for managing tons of product data, the interface of Shopware is not that bad. It's just really bad if you want to manage content. So it's just managing lists, and that's okay for a stock management system, but not for rich user experiences.
Thanks. I was trying to catch it. So,
Yeah, it's pretty cool what you're doing. Just to answer his question real quickly, there would be alternatives to Shopware. Spryker is a pretty good microservice architecture, and they provide a standalone product management interface. So it would be pretty easy to integrate Spryker microservices into Neos, probably. I haven't looked into it. But we use Shopware a lot because it's one of the best e-commerce systems, and the ecosystem is huge, especially if it comes to B2B or something like that. Currently, you're only using Neos to design elements for emotion pages, right?
Yes.
But emotion elements rely on very specific HTML annotations in order to work. If you wanna put a product into a checkout, you have to use data product checkout number blah in the HTML code. So basically, you need to teach your Neos developer how the HTML for Shopware needs to look like.
No. What we want to do with the API is that we want that, that Shopware API gives us a URL that we can use, so the rendering on the Neos side does not have to deal with such details.
Yeah, if you display it in Neos, it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
But if you export the components back into Shopware and render it using Fusion, which is pretty cool by the way, then you have to deal with that.
Yeah, in that case, the integrator on the Shopware side would have to create the URL first and pass it to the component. It is quite a different way to work on with Smarty, so it will be a challenge for them, but they get ready to use components, so they should be willing to learn a bit.
Okay.
And regarding other shop systems, when we created the transfer objects, they are not modeled one-to-one on the model of Shopware. So they are not a one-to-one reflection of Shopware. They are mainly a model of what information from a shop is relevant to a CMS system for rendering the information that comes from a shop. So it would absolutely be possible to create these DTOs from another shop as well. So the bridge can go anywhere. You might also think about replacing the CMS, but I see no reason why you should do this.
And another thing, Shopware uses nothing that is pretty similar to Atomic Design or anything. They use these weird less with a lot of injected variables during PHP yes. runtime. That's just nothing you would like to use in your Neos project.
No.
So you plan to write CSS for the components that is just ignoring everything that's Shopware standard and just overwrite it.
Yes.
Okay. Good
but,
decision.
But we have some experience doing that in Neos as well. So we create components that only rely on their own code. Okay. That's what we mean with presentational components.
What I'm a little bit interested in is you're using Monocle for exporting that components into Shopware. And do you use that idea also for other systems?
Yes, we also created, but that's more or less still experimental, we created an export to Typo3. And and the result of this export is that the Fusion components show up as fluid view helpers on the Typo3 side. But the component in this regard has a much nicer API than a partial or from fluid, since the component has an API that has names. So you know you don't have to pass arguments to a partial and have to know what this partial expects. You can pass a title to a teaser. So it makes much more sense and is much more easier for any integrator to use. But we don't use it in production yet.
More question. No more questions? Okay. 3, 2, 1. Okay, then we have no more questions. Then thank you very much for Martin and Wilhelm for this talk. And please do not forget Martin and Miriam, I'm sorry. Martin and our shopping queen is of course not Wilhelm, it's Miriam. But it would be a nice idea. And please rate for this talk.